In 2021, we asked, why is solar energy not everywhere yet? All the experts we spoke to said this.
It's going to be big. It's going to be everywhere.
I would not be surprised if by 2030, we're talking about solar doing a large part of the world's electricity supply.
And 4 years on, it looks like they were right.
A record 16 gigawatts of solar panel capacity.
India's first solar city.
Solar power for your own household.
Solar power is the fastest growing energy technology in the world. And by 2030, it is expected to be the largest renewable energy source, ahead of hydro and wind. But solar still isn't everywhere, yet. Some of the best places for it are still missing out. Get ready for a deep dive into the next great solar challenge. Today, energy from the sun is hands down one of the cheapest ways to make electricity in most countries around the world. In the US, it now costs around $60 to produce a megawatt hour of electricity with solar farms, only half as much as coal and a third of nuclear energy. It's also super flexible. You can use a small panel to power a single appliance, stick some together to power a house, or plug in some more to power a city. And recently, politicians worldwide have recognized just how good solar power is.
The economics of solar power you cannot ignore anymore.
Divyam Nagpal is a specialist for renewable energy at Sustainable Energy for All, an initiative launched by the United Nations.
Countries are recognizing that, they're introducing targets, bringing policies and plans to be able to deploy that.
All this has meant the amount of solar power that's been installed, aka solar capacity, is now triple what it was 5 years ago. And forecasts for the coming years keep being revised upwards. So solar power is cheap, it's practical, it's good for the climate. It sounds like a total no-brainer to build more and more. But there's one big thing holding it back from booming even more. Inequality.
Yeah, compare that to this.
Look at this map. It shows solar potential, essentially how much energy you can get out of each solar panel. You might notice there's a pretty wide spectrum. If we plot each country's solar potential on a chart, it looks like this. See how some European countries like Sweden and the Netherlands rank on the left on the low potential side? High potential countries, including Australia and the United Arab Emirates, can be found on the right side of this chart. They have more hours of sun per year to harvest for energy. And look where Namibia and Chile rank. One solar panel there could produce more than twice as much energy as one in Ireland or the UK. So you'd want a lot of solar panels in these countries, right? Well, that's not what's happening. Let's make this chart a little more interesting. Here's how much solar power the UK had installed in 2023, around 230 watt per person, as much as half a solar panel. And here's the rest of Europe, with the Netherlands and Germany at the top, with the highest capacity per person. Now here is the rest of the world. The top right corner is the absolute sweet spot, high potential and lots of solar panels installed. But it's empty up here, except for Australia. Most of the countries with the highest potential are still down here. Every single country in Africa has fewer solar panels per person than rainy, cloudy UK. So what do you do if you're one of these countries and you want to get up here? Some are going big. Take the United Arab Emirates, for instance. They recently built one of the biggest solar farms in the world, the Al Dafra Solar Power Project near Abu Dhabi. It has 4 million solar panels for a capacity of around 2 gigawatts and reportedly can provide energy for around 200,000 people. Large solar farms like these are the most cost-effective to build and maintain, which is why we're seeing more and more of them. These sorts of projects need space, money, and a stable electricity grid. And not all countries have all three. Even if you have space and money,
do you have the power system that can absorb that amount of utility-scale power, especially the transmission systems?
This is Ashish Khanna. He is the Director General of the International Solar Alliance and has been working on expanding solar power for more than 20 years. Today's electrical grids weren't really built with solar power in mind, so most countries are still working out how their energy grids need to adapt. Chile, for example, gets its solar power from large farms in the sunny north. They're being built so fast that their electrical grid hasn't kept up with the influx of energy. So to keep the grid from overloading, Chile has to throw away almost 20% of the renewable energy they produce. These problems can spook investors.
if the investor does not see a long-term policy certainty and a minimum return, it often leads to problems of either an interest or a very high tariff.
This is a big issue for almost all forms of solar power. Most investment in renewable energy still happens in rich countries, many of which are on the low potential side of our chart, while many on the high potential side are struggling to find the funds.
Today, most countries do not have a very strong policy, regulatory, and governance environment that is conducive for private sector investment.
So, big solar farms like the ones in the Middle East need modern grids and lots of money, which many of the high potential countries in our chart don't have right now. Luckily, giant farms aren't the only way to build out solar power.
India is a recent entry in trying to have a very large target of upwards of 40 gigawatts to be done on solar rooftops.
The idea of solar rooftops is simple but genius. Let people make electricity right where they use it, in their own homes and businesses. Ideally, it's a win-win-win. Lower energy bills for consumers, less pressure on electrical grids, and more clean energy in the world. No wonder the idea is popular everywhere. A solar rooftop may be cheaper than a whole solar farm, but it's still a big investment for homeowners. That's why many governments, including India, subsidize the upfront cost of installing solar power with national and regional programs, like here in Ladakh. In Germany, which has a lot of solar power installed already, some cities even offer rebates for renters. A little balcony plant like this might cost around 500 euros, 250 of which the city of Berlin will reimburse. Apart from subsidies, many countries also let you feed surplus energy back to the grid and get paid for it. Versions of this exist, for example, in many states of the US, Australia, and India, as well as some European countries.
Solar rooftop's biggest strength is it empowers individuals to start earning money based on their asset, which is the house.
Even without any government incentives, the energy security that solar power offers is worth a lot. Where governments don't step in, people take out private loans or dip into personal savings to be able to afford solar panels.
You ask anybody on the street what they're saving up to if they have that capacity, and the first answer became solar panels for a lot of the consumers.
Mohammed Mustafa Amjad works for the Renewables First think tank in Pakistan, where solar panels have become a way out of steep electricity prices and frequent power outages. The shift has been massive. In 2022, Pakistan imported around 2.8 gigawatts of solar panels. In 2024, 17 gigawatts. The country now produces more than 10% of its energy from solar power, more than the global average. From a government's perspective, rooftops can be a great place to start putting up solar panels. It doesn't require so much money at once and can be more independent from the electrical grid. Financial support from the government can help people make the switch more easily. For them, solar power means energy independence. And that is particularly important where power from the grid is expensive, unreliable, or not available at all. In sub-Saharan Africa in particular, a lot of people aren't connected to any form of electricity, let alone a stable grid.
Whether you need healthcare, whether you need digitization, whether you need agriculture or school, you need electricity as a basic human right. So for countries in Africa, solar is about finding solutions for energy access.
Ashish Khanna worked with a lot of African countries on just this when he led the World Bank program Mission 300, which aims to give 300 million people in sub-Saharan Africa access to energy by 2030. It does this, for instance, by supporting mini-grids that provide power to small communities like here in rural Nigeria. They also support businesses that offer standalone systems like solar-powered light bulbs, motors, or cooling systems. These are also popular in other parts of the world, like here in India.
We no longer have to wait for large infrastructure to be built by government, which takes decades. Now we can move faster, move much more quicker in terms of making sure that everybody has access to energy.
If things go according to plans laid out by the African Union, then by 2030, the energy network in sub-Saharan Africa could look a little like this. In addition to existing and planned transmission lines for the electrical grid, these blue lines here, there would be plenty of mini-grids, shown in red, and standalone systems, shown in green, to fill the gaps in rural areas.
we're aiming for the moon, but it's not as though it's not been done. We've landed on the moon before, right? It's extremely doable. And I think the blueprint to be able to achieve that in terms of investment mobilization, policy that are required, the capacities that are required, the industries that are required, the value chains that are required, it all exists. We know exactly what needs to be done.
There are still lots of people in the world that don't have access to clean electricity. But solar power seems to be in a good position to change that. At the 2023 climate conference, nearly 200 countries signed a pledge to triple renewable energy capacity by 2030. And so far, it looks like we're pretty much on track, with solar power making up most of the new additions. That means that in 2030, there could be 2 solar panels installed for every person in the world. And it would be smart to put a lot of those right here.
And the economics of solar power is so good right now. If you're advanced, if you're fast developing, if you need energy access, or if your island countries, solar will be part of your energy solution.
The great thing here is that every little bit helps. Every solar panel, solar rooftop, and mini grid that goes online not only helps us ditch the fossil fuels that are destroying our climate, reliable, independent electricity also makes a massive difference to many people's daily lives. Are you seeing a difference because of solar subsidies or a new mini grid where you live? Let us know in the comments below and follow for more videos like this.